morning. So we stay on the English. I'm very sorry. I would very much like to speak German, which is a very beautiful language. But unfortunately, it's not possible. I'm not an expert of intelligent cities, and maybe with some proud idea of myself, I think I'm an expert of cities. So I would like to start this conversation by that, by cities that are changing, that have changed very rapidly in the last decades. The century of city, as has been said, maybe. But what are the cities? The cities that we imagine to be intelligent. Cities are something like this, for example. Part of Europe, part of Germany, Belgium, France, Paris, London. This is the European city, where you don't distinguish anymore what is city, what is non-city. In fact, we citizens of these cities, we are urban people, wherever we live. It's not fundamental that we live in the center of Paris to be urban or to be metropolitan. We can live also in the periphery, in the radiant periphery of Belgium, for example, and we are urban at the same level, with the same access to what an urban or a metropolitan citizen can access. So first of all, I think we have to go beyond all the distinctions between what is city and what is non-city, and to reflect deeply on the new configurations, the new form of the city. This new form of the city has been widely investigated in the past century. Is it at least one century? We are trying to reformulating what is, in fact, an urban condition, what is a city. And you see here some of the definitions that have been brought and discussed. Each of them was being imagined from very concrete situations, concrete territorial urban situations. As you probably know, the Zwischenstadt that Thomas Sievert has defined for some parts of Germany. Or maybe you know something about the city territory that was proposed in the 60s, so 50, 60 years ago. The diffuse city, the Stadtlandschaft, or the ville paysage, as it has been used in French, the banlieue radieuse, the tapete metropole in the Dutch context. The idea of urban conditions, so rural and urban at the same time. This is the city we are facing today. And when you look at some metropolitan area, you can immediately understand that there are different spatial configuration. And the question is, of course, what is the role of space? The fact that this is Paris, greater Paris, bigger concentrated density, but also you see becoming more and more spread and following certain directions, certain infrastructures. In the middle, you see the metropolitan region of Brussels, a very fine grain, and then there on the left, you see the Randstad, a different type of fragmented situation, which is completely different from the Belgian one, for example. And of course, you live in a different way, but at the same time, you are completely urban and metropolitan in both situations. What is the character of, especially if we take the column in the center, so the, for example, the Brussels metropolitan region in general, Flanders, Belgium, what is the character of this extended urbanization? But first of all, there are a lot of infrastructures. And of course, here we are talking of physical infrastructures, roads, canals, railway lines. So you can more or less access and live everywhere in these large urban territories, which doesn't mean that they are homogeneous, they are repetitive. On the contrary, they are very well oriented by some territorial figures, rivers, important infrastructural lines, more and more connected, so meshing this type of metropolis. And there are a lot of, like we can say, recognizable spaces that can be the big attractors of a metropolitan area, the big airport, the centers of the city, but also big natural figures like the big forest, for example, in Brussels. So in fact, it's a very heterogeneous urban condition, extremely rich and extremely also strong in economic terms. The metropolitan revolution, as has been defined by authors like Peter Katz in the US, is simply saying that this type of environment are extremely rich and they produce a big part of our wealth that is not produced in the centers. It is produced in this very fragmented, heterogeneous, mixed type of urban condition. And what is interesting is that the cities, the old cities, they can play, of course, a role inside this, network. And the public transport is not only, should not be only conceived in function of the old cities, but really in function of the mobility of this type of territory. In the case of Belgium, we proposed in the vision for Brussels 2040 to reflect on the fact that this density of infrastructures, mobility infrastructures, could be considered as a starting point for a radical scenario in which cars might disappear, so a no-car scenario. And organizing the territory on the basis of this dense network of mobility infrastructure not related to the car use. And of course, we can imagine an incremental process of connecting step by step the different parts, and start with the no-car islands that then are connected by some lines, and in the longer term, to arrive to a territory, a region, that can work without cars. This is possible. This is, of course, one of the important challenges for the digital intelligent city. How can we make this transition to a different type of mobility? A mobility, plural mobilities, where in fact it will be only by collecting different modes. We will walk more, we will use more our bicycle, we will use more the train, we will use more the tramway, we will use more the bus, we will share some vehicles, we will share some taxi, collective taxi. So it is by the imagination of the plurality of the modes of moving in space that we can imagine to go beyond this very, very short period that was a period dominated by the car. But that is in the history, will be just a small part of history. What is interesting in this type of as we said, horizontal metropolis, so where are all the characters of the metropolis, but not the traditional idea of a concentration, vertical construction in which there is only one center and the rest is a vast periphery. So in this horizontal metropolis, people are quite happy to live. If you have, first of all, this image on the right, and the left is about social inequality, so where the poor live. Poor are in red, red and yellow. And the second one is about the appreciation of the environment. So we can see that the people that do not appreciate the environment, they live more or less in the center of Brussels. In the center, I mean along the canal, the old industrial part of the city of Brussels, where poverty, immigration is more concentrated. But you see there, the social inequality, we see there is also poverty in the southern fringe of Brussels, that is the old mine valleys. But in this case, when you ask to the people that are in fact a fragile part of the population, but they appreciate a lot the context where they live. While the poor that live in the center of Brussels along this old industrial strip that is crossing the city, they don't like the place where they live. So we understand that this horizontal condition is in a way bringing also qualities, a quality of landscapes, is a quality of relations. And people, in fact, maybe they are not rich maybe they suffer of some inequalities, but they like the place. And this is an very important strength, I think, of the horizontal metropolis, that we should rely on the appreciation by the citizens of this type of space. And humanity is living, of course, in the core centers and is living also in favelas, but the big part, the majority of people, is living in this type of urban situation. I have to accelerate a little bit. So the problem in our case was not really the fringe, not really the periphery, the so-called periphery, that's living quite well, in fact, but it's more inside the denser part of the city. And for this reason, we reflected on projects that were connecting different types of questions. For example, the risk of flooding that we see in the hydrological structure of the city, the possibility to valorize the fertile soils of the western part of the Brussels metropolitan region, that are the most fertile areas, while the eastern are more sandy with forest. And joining this with an idea of reinforcing the clusters of schools, because in this part of the metropolis, there will be the most part of the immigration that will arrive. And when I'm speaking of immigration, I'm mainly considering the poor part of immigration, not the expat going in Brussels to work for the EU community. And schools, so places for education, together with a mesh of public transport and soft mobility. So these three levels, they construct altogether the idea of the Western gardens, very productive from the soil and the land point of view, productive in terms of agriculture, coupled with the new type of educational clusters, not small schools isolated and in ghettos, but bigger educational open type of space for education, in order to integrate, to be used in multiple ways, and in fact imagining a space that has nothing revolutionary, I would say, it's very simple, but where you have the place for the flooding, the wetlands, where you have the public space, where you have the space for the new agriculture together with new practices, urban practices, and where you have the schools that becomes a new kind of centralities inside this more problematic part of the horizontal metropolis. We are talking here of interior peripheries, because peripheries will not be peripheries anymore. They will not be on the outside, on the edges. They will be inside, and that's something we have to integrate. And from there, arriving until really the most problematic part, that is the canal area, where the transformations should maintain this very interesting heterogeneous grain of fabric, because the old industries were there, so there is a flexibility of spaces where new activities might be imagined, while today what is happening is the idea of the tabula rasa, new neighborhoods imagined for people that will live on top of a tower looking towards the water. But what we need is also to have jobs, to have labor, and not only high-skill laborers, but also low-skill, because in general, the poor part of the population is not exactly top high-skill. So we need this multiplicity of spaces in the cities for the multiplicity of activities inside the city, and not, as we are doing in Europe still today, negating the space for the work, for even manufacture, for example. And this was a way to represent this idea of horizontality, where different scattered centralities can organize, and where some big infrastructures are in a way open and connected to all the territory. The second part is very short. By reflecting on the horizontal metropolis and by reflecting on the challenges today, also related to digitization and a different type of infrastructures that will structure our cities, I think we really have to stop a moment and reflect on what type of space, what type of structure we are imagining. In the 60s, a very old quotation, Christopher Alexander was saying, like with a lot of ingenuity in a way, the city is not a tree. And we continue to imagine cities as a very strongly hierarchical systems and organizations, center, periphery, inside, outside, vertical versus horizontal. So the city is not a tree, and we have problems, mental problems, to imagine something that should be, can be organized, can be even ordered without using the figure of hierarchy. We have a problem, mental problem. But in fact, we are reflecting, since there is a traditional on reflection, on horizontality. This is again from the 60s, Weber, no? It was saying and trying to represent this horizontality by saying that in fact, the urban, no, it's not something unitary, and it's an interpenetration of different types of spaces and realm. And in fact, it's much better to imagine space as horizontally stratified, much more than structured by strong hierarchy. Also because, in fact, those hierarchies are very often very fake hierarchies. Or there are architects, artists, mathematicians, philosophers. Jean Petitot has been one of the most important, reflecting on a-centered structure. Why do we need a center? Why we need a center? There are structures that are working without one center, maybe with multiple centers, but the idea of needing hierarchy to organize a public transport system, the idea to need a center each time you speak about the city, the incapacity we have to conceive and to work with different ideas of order, I think it's extremely big problem. And the horizontal metropolis is in a way addressing this this question. And of course, digital technologies can play a fundamental role here, can, but they will do, will make this only if we want them to do that. And because we, in fact, we, in this, inside this horizontal metropolis, we have interior peripheries. Peripheries, this is the interior, marginal, considered areas in Italy. So we can say Italy is all made of those areas, the big part of the surface. Of course, there are some mountains inside, but it's quite impressive. What is in white is what can be now today considered one big city. Continuities from Milan, east-west of Italy is fundamentally one conurbation. From Milan going to the Adriatic Sea is one line of cities, et cetera, et cetera. Along the Adriatic coast, there is one city. So, okay, that's the white and the black, but look at also at the red. And the red is an impressive part of the territory that is disconnected, more marginal, with less services, et cetera. One big interior periphery of Europe are the Alps, the mountains. So in which way the new technologies can really reframe the idea of marginality, of interior periphery, inside this idea of horizontal metropolis. If I take the Leman area along the lake of Geneva and of Lausanne, and we integrate in the metropolitan idea of a metropolis around or on one side of the lake, because the southern side of the lake is much more marginal, it's in the French side, while the north side is the Swiss side. So there are very contrasted conditions in terms of social of population. And what if we integrate the Alps inside this idea of metropolitan area, not leaving them aside? What if we imagine that the hydraulic system can play a fundamental role in structuring in a weak way? These are not the strong infrastructure, for example, the TOD, transit-oriented development, structuring hierarchically the city. These are much weaker structures. They have been completely frustrated in the past. Water has been destroyed, hidden, etc. So it's something you have to recover. And maybe using some hypotheses, how can we use the current growth of those metropolis to reinforce the inhabitability of the territory, which has been inhabited since centuries or millennia. But today, if we leave this part of the territory, and I'm speaking of the mountains in particular, as only resort or as fresh or as a kind of garden for the citizens, but we are losing also a big part of the infrastructures that have been realized in the mountains. And we can imagine, on the contrary, so that's, for example, in one of those valleys, how we can imagine to reconsider this type of territories that are urban, as urban as other part of the horizontal metropolis, where impressive infrastructure have been realized to guide the Rhône river inside this narrow bed, in which today we have to reinvest hundreds of millions to give space to the water, because in fact with climate change this is will not be able to resist, and there are problems for the economy of these valleys. How can we rethink, I would say very quickly, in the section of this valley, all the different possibilities of productivity, of valorization, of recycling, what is there. For example, in those alpine valleys, you can find five, six, seven airports, because there has been a moment in the war period in which the alpine valleys were considered the last space where to retreat in case of invasion. And then you can find an immense amount of military infrastructures that are there that you can rethink today, together with economies of the plain, economies of the slopes, economy of the plateau, and climate change will give the possibility to cultivate to higher levels. So it's something really to reconceive. And of course, the role of digitization can be fundamental to have this type of internal peripheries to work for the best in the future. You see, the theme here is to reuse old military infrastructures, but also to invest in some infrastructures of accessibility in order to guarantee to the people that we would like to remain there. We are saying that this is the case of the growth of the Swiss country forecast for 2040. This growth should not be concentrated only in the cities, which are already dense and which are already a lot of services, but they should be used, this growth of population, to restructure and to requalify and to recycle what has been realized in our territories that have been used and inhabited since a long time. Only through this type of reflection, I think we can really work on the city territory, so this new urban dimension, as a renewable resource. So not only as the process of waste, as we have been considering the urban growth in the past, but also as a space that can be continuously recycled, and by this becoming a sort of renewable resource. It is a resource for sure. The question is, can it be a renewable resource? Okay, to conclude, I think that what we are facing, and of course the digitization will play a fundamental role in this, is a redefinition of the relation between space and life. So it's in fact a new biopolitical project that we are discussing. The old biopolitical project, the one in which urbanism, modern urbanism, was one of the important, arms, producing a space, the space for the industrial city, the space that was divided in functions, a space that was quite heavily infrastructured and hierarchical. Well, this space and that biopolitical project is gone. We are now swimming in a very ambiguous situation where I think we should really address the bigger questions. And I suggest three main fields of reflection. First of all, of course, the question of the bio power. So is a power intended to govern life? And we have to reframe this point. The second is the impact of the new ecological awareness to the extent of deep ecology reflection, deep ecology, so where you accept the non-centrality of humankind in the global living species. And the third one, what about the emancipation of the subject? I don't think that the reconfiguration of a biopolitical project can forget the fact that we have been living through at least some centuries in which the subject had the impression, each step, to be better for his or her emancipation. So in which way the idea of horizontal metropolis, of going beyond the stereotypes of hierarchy for isotropic territories, porous and permeable and connected territories, can avoid interior peripheries, peripheries that will be inside, close to every one of us, and suggest new reflections about a new biopolitical project. Thank you.